What is the blasphemy of the Holy Spirit? That's a question and a topic that has caused many believers to become fearful. And more importantly, people want to know, have I committed the blasphemy of the Holy Spirit? And will I ever be forgiven? So these questions are important because Jesus did teach that there is a sin that cannot be forgiven. Stephen Moctezuma is here with me as usual. He's going to be leading you in some worship, and then we're going to come back and address this topic head on. I want to make sure that we get detailed and specific with biblical answers that are sound. And as you listen today, it is my prayer that God would bring peace to your heart and clarity to your mind. Stephen Moctezuma is going to take you into some worship right now.
Nails in your hands, nails in your feet, they tell me how much you love me. The thorns on your brow, they tell me how you pour so much pain to love me. The nails in your hand, the nail in your feet, they tell me how much you love me. The thorns on your brow, they tell me how you pour so much pain to love me. And when the heavens pass away, all your scars will still remain, and forever they will say how much you love me. So I want to say, forever my love, forever my heart, forever my life is yours. Forever my love, forever my heart, forever my life is yours. Forever, forever my love, forever my heart, forever my life is yours. Forever, forever my love, forever my heart, forever my life is yours.
Thank you to my friend Stephen Moctezuma. We definitely appreciate his worship ministry. If you enjoy the worship ministry of Stephen Moctezuma, be sure to check out his playlist here on Encounter TV. Okay, so let's get into this topic. What is the blasphemy of the Holy Spirit? I don't think a week has gone by since I've been in ministry that's been broadcast on television. I don't think a week has gone by where I have not been sent in one form of correspondence or another this question. Typically, when somebody sends this question, they're very fearful, they're very worried, they're very paranoid, they're very panicked, they're very apprehensive, and all those other words that you can use to describe fear. And they call in, they email. I remember I was speaking with one gentleman on the phone. He was breathing heavy, he was nervous, his speech was fast and paranoid, and I could just tell that this person I was talking to was just absolutely tormented by the thought by the idea that he could have possibly committed the blasphemy of the Holy Spirit. And really, it concerns me because my heart does go out to those of you who are overthinkers such as myself. God has gifted me with a mind that likes to analyze. I lean more on intellect than I do on emotion. So I have to be very careful when I approach certain topics that I don't overthink things. And God has really helped me with that over the years. But still, this topic has caused a lot of fear in many people. And even if it hasn't caused you any fear, it's good to know what the Bible teaches concerning this topic so that you can help minister to others who are questioning this specific point. So there's the tormented overthinker who thinks they've committed the unpardonable sin because it's something that caused them great discomfort, or maybe something in their mind that was very vile and they can't imagine that God would forgive. So we're going to go through the scripture today. We're going to look at this verse in a very detailed fashion, and we're going to give some very clear, biblically based answers. I'm not going to make emphasis where the scripture is vague. I'm not going to become dogmatic where the scripture is silent. I'm just going to give you very clearly what the Bible teaches. So, first of all, the scripture does give us great comfort to know that God is not the giver of fear. 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 7 says this, "For God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind." So my first point before we get into the study is don't be afraid. Don't study this based in fear. Don't look at this and fret. Don't be tormented by the lies of the enemy. And it is the lie of the enemy that causes this fear, because God is not the giver of the spirit of fear. He's the giver of the sound mind. And God wants to give you a sound mind concerning this topic. He also wants you to be informed so that you can help others who want to know about this topic. And I think it's just our responsibility as believers to become familiar with questions that are biblically popular. So first of all, don't be afraid. Second of all, we need to be very careful to weigh scripture with scripture. You know, oftentimes we'll read a verse of the Bible and it could give a certain impression if we disregard the context and the meaning. And trying to force their purpose and their meaning into certain verses, many unknowingly and unwillingly twist the scripture to something that suits what they would rather believe. Now, this is not healthy to do, because we have to compare scripture with scripture. Why? Because all of it is the word of God, and God will not contradict himself. So if you ever find something where there seems to be a contradiction in scripture, typically you're looking at something that's very specific. For example, there's a story of a man who sinned, and or that the disciples and the people around Jesus asked if he sinned. There's a man that Jesus was healing. And the people asked Jesus, "Lord, what did this man do? What was his sin, or his mother and father's sin, that caused him to be sick?" And Jesus said, no, it wasn't sin that caused this man's sickness, but he was sick so that to the glory of God, he could be made whole and affirm the message or whatever it is that the people were looking on saw and what they received from that event. So in that instance, you can look at it and say, well, no sin has ever caused sickness, or no sickness has ever been caused by sin. But that would be incorrect, because the Bible later in the New Testament, in the writings of Paul, affirms that some people were sick because they drank of the cup of the Lord unworthily. So what is this? Do we have a contradiction? No. All it tells us is that in some cases, some sickness is caused by sin, and in other cases, it's not. So that's one example of why comparing scripture with scripture is important, so that you don't become dogmatic or general where the scripture means to be specific and purposeful and intentional. So we have to compare scripture with scripture. We have to realize there's no contradictions in the Bible. And then we have to look at the context, the entirety of where we see a word, a verse, and a chapter. You know, often people ask me, what are my study methods? And we've actually had a lot of people write in, because sometimes I'll open my Bible and they'll notice there's certain highlight marks on there. Just for example, I'll give this to you because many of you have asked, and so I'll just tell you real quickly. I highlight anything that has to do with the Holy Spirit in yellow, anything that has to do with healing in green, anything that has to do with God's presence in red, anything that has to do with spiritual warfare or prayer in orange. I do light blue for salvation and the gospel. I do dark purple for faith. I do dark blue for giving and generosity. And I do light pink for ministry or leadership verses. So that's my structure on the Bible. But what I like to do is, often we challenge ourselves to read a certain amount of the Bible by a certain amount of time. And I'm all for that. I'm all for the Bible in a year reading plans and whatnot. But me personally, what I like to do is people ask me, well, how long does it take you to read a verse or a chapter of the Bible? You know, it can take me as much as a week to read a chapter of the Bible. Because I don't just read it and skim through it. I read it and comb through it very carefully. And if I don't understand something, I'll go back. What I do is I pick it apart. First, I look at the entire book. What is the message of the entire book? Then I look at it divided by chapters. Now, we know that in Scripture there were no chapters originally, but the chapters were inserted at certain points because of the context. And I'm sure they serve some purpose written by those who have observed the Scripture very clearly. So then I'll look at the chapters and the sections and the themes that you can find inside of that one overall theme of the entire book. And then after I've looked at the book, after I've looked at the sections, then I look at the verses and I look at what they mean piece by piece. And then finally, I look at what they mean word for word. This is not to say that I do Greek and Hebrew studies for every word of the Bible, but for key concepts, I will look at a Greek or a Hebrew word. So then after I've understood that, then I go back out again and read it all over. And that's how I take in the Bible, very slowly, very methodically. I don't rush it. I eat it like it's a fine dining meal. You just go in and you enjoy it. So that's what I do. And so that's where I want to tell you that context does matter. So number one, don't be afraid. Number two, compare Scripture with Scripture. Don't be given to emotion. Be given to the Spirit, who will help you to understand, because it's by the Holy Spirit that we look to the Word and understand what God is saying to us. And number three, I want to tell you that when it comes to this topic in particular, Jesus meant it to be harsh. And so I want to tread very lightly on this topic. These words that we find that have to do with the blasphemy of the Holy Spirit are found in three of the four Gospels. Now, I'm not so concerned with comforting people that I downplay Christ's words. My explanation is in no way an attempt to do away with the harshness. In fact, I'm going to emphasize today the harshness with which Christ spoke these controversial words. Jesus meant to be harsh here. I'm not going to work to inspire comfort and a relaxed attitude where Christ himself has purposed himself to speak words that bring great reverence. So Christ, by speaking of the blasphemy of the Holy Spirit, his intention was to inspire a profound reverence for the person of the Holy Spirit. So I'm not in any way today trying to downplay those words or make you take them any lightly than you should. In fact, as I approach the Scripture, I think of the verse in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 11, where the Scripture says, "Knowing therefore the terror of the Lord, we persuade men." The Scripture also talks about a greater judgment coming upon those who teach the word. We're going to be held to a higher standard. So knowing that, I work very, very carefully to not inspire relaxation where Christ has worked to inspire profound reverence. So number one, don't be afraid. Number two, you have to be thoughtful, methodical. You have to compare Scripture with Scripture. Number three, you do have to tread with great reverence on topics like these. So let's go now to the Scripture. And we're going to look first at the key verse. So this is found Matthew chapter 12, verse 31 and 32. This is the key verse right here. And this is Jesus talking. "So I tell you, every sin and blasphemy can be forgiven, except blasphemy against the Holy Spirit, which will never be forgiven. Anyone who speaks against the Son of Man can be forgiven, but anyone who speaks against the Holy Spirit will never be forgiven, either in this world or in the world to come." That's terrifying, if you ask me, and I can understand why this has caused some to live in fear. Because the truth behind this is very harsh. And there is certainly a sin that you can commit that would ensure that you would never be forgiven, not in this life or the next. Now, as we explore this Scripture, we're going to find out exactly what that looks like and how that then applies to our life, especially if we think we've already committed it, because that's the greatest fear. When you hear these words, the first thing is you ask yourself is you think back and you start going, well, was that the sin of the blasphemy of the Holy Spirit? Was that it? Was that? And we start to question all these different things. But we have to, again, approach this very carefully, very reverently, but with the peace of God in our hearts and scripture with scripture. So let's continue with these thoughts here. So looking at this scripture, you do the Greek study however you want. Never really means never. That word never in these verses, verse 31 and 32 of Matthew 12, never really means never. And forgiven really means literally forgiven. Therefore, never forgiven literally means never forgiven. And that's just what the Bible says. So that soul cannot be forgiven, not in this world, not in this lifetime, and not in eternity. And that's coming from Jesus, or the age to come, as the scripture puts it. So this is a big deal. This is something we have to understand. This is something we need to know. And we have to pay attention when Christ is making an emphasis like this. So that was the key verse. Now, number two, let's look at the context. Let's look at this in its entirety. So go to Matthew chapter 12. This is where we're going to be. Matthew chapter 12. I'm going to begin reading at verse 22 and stop reading at verse 37. This is the entire context of this specific incident, okay? So this is what the scripture says. It starts with a demon possession. So it's a very dramatic beginning to this whole dialogue. So then a demon-possessed man, this is verse 22 of Matthew 12, then a demon-possessed man who was blind and couldn't speak was brought to Jesus. He healed the man so that he could both speak and see. Verse 23, the crowd was amazed and asked, could it be that Jesus, the son of David, is the Messiah? Or could it be that Jesus is the son of David, the Messiah? Verse 24, but when the Pharisees heard about the miracle, they said, no wonder he can cast out demons. He gets his power from Satan, the prince of demons. Verse 25, Jesus knew their thoughts and replied, any kingdom divided by civil war is doomed. A town or family splintered by feuding will fall apart. And if Satan is casting out Satan, he is divided and fighting against himself. His own kingdom will not survive. And if I am empowered by Satan, what about your own exorcists? They cast out demons too, so will they condemn you for what you have said? But if I am casting out demons by the Spirit of God, then the kingdom of God has arrived among you. Verse 29, for who is powerful enough to enter the house of a strong man like Satan and plunder his goods? Or only someone even stronger, someone who could tie him up and then plunder his house. Anyone who isn't with me opposes me, and anyone who isn't working with me is actually working against me. Verse 31, so I tell you, every sin and blasphemy can be forgiven, except blasphemy against the Holy Spirit, which will, again, never be forgiven. Anyone who speaks against the Son of Man can be forgiven, but anyone who speaks against the Holy Spirit will never be forgiven, either in this world or in the world to come. A tree is identified by its fruit. If a tree is good, its fruit will be good. If a tree is bad, its fruit will be bad. You brood of snakes, how could evil men like you speak what is good and right? For whatever is in your heart determines what you say. A good person produces good things from the treasury of a good heart, and an evil person produces evil things from the treasury of an evil heart. And I tell you this, you must give an account on judgment day for every idle word you speak. Verse 37, the words you say will either acquit you or condemn you. So that's the entire context. Now looking at this, first we have to ask ourselves the context, and we see it here, it's very clearly. The Pharisees, who were the religious leaders of the time, were very opposed to what Christ was doing. They were representatives of the old law or the old covenant, the Old Testament. And rather than emphasize the things that Christ was emphasizing and what God tried to emphasize originally in the Old Testament, such as the heart or holiness or righteousness or mercy or love, they rather chose to affirm the systems and the rituals and the sacrifices, and they held people to a higher standard than God actually held them to. See, the scripture teaches that God is not looking necessarily for sacrifices. Even in the Old Testament, it says he wants a broken spirit and a contrite heart. So these are men who are very proud, very stubborn, very hard-hearted, and very anti-Christ, because they wanted to charge people for the rituals that supposedly would get them into heaven. Even Jesus accused them, saying, you keep people out of heaven. You don't even go into heaven yourselves, and then you make it harder for other people to enter. There's going to be a great judgment on you. So those are the religious leaders that Jesus is talking to. Now, what are they often trying to do? The religious leaders are often trying to trap Christ in an enigma. So this is the problem, though. They're dealing with the Son of God, so they're not going to be able to trap him. He's wiser than anyone who's ever walked the earth. And also, what did they hear or witness? It's possible they could have inquired about what they saw. So the scripture says that they were told of this exorcism that had occurred. But I think that they were there to witness it, and they were asking what happened here, even though they had laid witness to it. And some of the crowds told them that they heard in the crowd that people were saying, this could be the Messiah, this could be the Son of God. And the Pharisees, that bothered them, because then they'd sort of be out of a job if this is the Messiah and they no longer had the only path to God, or the supposed path to God. And so they come in and they see that Jesus had cast a demon out of a man, simultaneously healing him. So here's the Son of God right before their very eyes. He casts out a devil and he casts out the sickness. The people begin to be amazed. They begin to talk, maybe this is the Messiah. And the Pharisees say, we have to come up with something. They don't want people following Jesus. They want people following them. So they're looking at the crowd. They're looking at the situation. And very quickly, out of their heart, remember, because the scripture says, out of the heart, the mouth speaks, they come up with this explanation. They say, well, Jesus was able to cast out the demons because he uses the power of Satan. And he's possessed by the devil himself. Now think about that. What an ugly accusation. So whose power was really at work in this verse? In this context, verse 28 tells us whose power was at work. Verse 28 says, but if I am casting out demons by the Spirit of God. Think about that. Jesus was casting out demons by the Holy Spirit's power. And these men, these Pharisees, these teachers of religious law, they're watching him do this. They're angry that he's drawing a crowd and drawing accolades unto himself. Not purposely, he's bringing glory to God, but they don't catch that. And they're bothered and they come up with this explanation. They say, well, this man, he's casting out the devil by demonic power. So there they are labeling the work of the Holy Spirit as demonic. Even worse, they're basically accusing Christ of being Satan himself by saying that Christ is possessed by the devil himself. What an absolutely horrific accusation. When you think of the beauty of the Immaculate Conception, when you think of the beauty and the purity and the holiness and the power and the divinity behind the birth of Jesus, born unto the Virgin Mary, the miracle that was, when you think of all that took place for God to come in the form of a man, when you think that a holy God filled with love in his heart was so pulled by his compassion that he responded by coming to earth himself through the power of the Holy Spirit and through the will of God, making himself a man, subjecting himself to our laws, stripping off all things that made him godlike except for the power of the Holy Spirit. When you think of that love, such selflessness, such purity, such beauty, and then for them to call that satanic, what an ugly accusation, that they would compare the Son of God, God incarnate, God among men, to the devil. So this is a very deep accusation they are making. So we see, though, that it is the power of the Holy Spirit at work. Now, is that it? Is attributing the power of the Holy Spirit to a demonic power, the blasphemy of the Holy Spirit? In a way it is, but I think the scripture gives us more details. Let's look further. The Holy Spirit's power is demonic, they're saying, and Jesus is possessed by Satan. So they're rejecting the power of the Holy Spirit and the identity of Christ. So in Mark, though, remember I told you that this story is not just found in this context, but it's also found in Mark. Mark chapter 3, verse 30 gives us very clear insight as to why Jesus told those words to the Pharisees. Now, I don't know for sure And I studied all three accounts. We don't know whether the Pharisees were very close to committing the blasphemy of the Holy Spirit or had committed the blasphemy of the Holy Spirit. It doesn't really say exactly. I mean, many people say they definitely committed it. Some people say they were very close to committing it and Jesus was giving them a warning. We don't know. But either they committed it or came very close to committing it. Still, Mark chapter 3, verse 30 gives us very clear insight into this situation when Jesus says, if you blaspheme the Holy Spirit, you won't be forgiven in this life or the next. The Bible tells us exactly why he said that to the Pharisees. And it says it in Mark chapter 3, verse 30. This is the verse. He told them this because they were saying he's possessed by an evil spirit. Okay? So we know that the blasphemy of the Holy Spirit was something they said. It was something that they spoke. And Jesus emphasizes this point later in Matthew chapter 12, verse 36, I believe, or verse 35, talks about what's coming out of the heart, what they're speaking. So their words is what the blasphemy was. So before we draw some conclusions now, I'm gonna bring this to some conclusions in just a moment. But we've so far seen the verse, we've seen the context, but let's take a look at that word blasphemy. So we can look at all three. So the next thing, the word itself. We've seen the context, we've seen the verse. Now let's look at the word blasphemy. So blasphemia is the Greek word. I don't know if I'm pronouncing that correctly. I believe it's blasphemia. This word appears 19 times in the New Testament, and it means to slander. It's a detraction, or it's speech injurious to another's, to someone's good name. So it's slander. It's tearing someone down with your words. Now, interestingly enough, this noun is a feminine noun. Remember, we talked about this a few lessons ago about the Holy Spirit's feminine qualities. Not that he's a male or female. He doesn't have a gender, but that there's a feminine quality in some scriptures referring to the Holy Spirit. So that blasphemy, blasphemia would be a feminine noun is at least interesting to me anyway. So we can automatically, by looking at this word, rule out some sins. The blasphemy of the Holy Spirit is not murder. It's not suicide. Some people have said that suicide is the sin that can never be forgiven. So now those of you who've lost loved ones to suicide can take comfort in knowing that that's not the unpardonable sin. Because the scripture says there's only one sin that can't be forgiven in this world or the next. And if suicide was one of them, that would have been mentioned. But suicide's not one of them. It's what's spoken, not what's done. Fornication, some people have thought that's it. Some people thought it's witchcraft. Some people think it's adultery. And basically, this is where people get paranoid. Is anything they do or say in regards to the Holy Spirit, they think that's the blasphemy. Like I had someone say, well, I faked speaking in tongues. Did I commit the blasphemy of the Holy Spirit? I pretended to be slain in the Spirit. Did I commit the blasphemy of the Holy Spirit? I was a little skeptical of what was happening in the service. Did I commit the blasphemy of the Holy Spirit? No, no, and no. The blasphemy of the Holy Spirit is a sin of the tongue. It's something that is said. So we know that because of the word blasphemy. So let's now bring some conclusions to this and narrow it down to what this is. So some people at this point would interject, and this is a very common explanation. They would say, well, the blasphemy of the Holy Spirit is when you don't believe until you die, or they call it unbelief until death. In other words, it is the rejection of God's salvation. It is stubborn unwillingness to follow God's law, his path into salvation, and therefore you're destroyed in the end. But remember Jesus' words. He said, the one who commits this sin will not be forgiven in this world or the next. So it can't be unbelief until death, because you can commit it on this side of eternity. If it was unbelief until death, then it's a sin that would be committed after you died. So unbelief until death is ruled out because Jesus himself said in this world. Plus the idea, there's another idea where the unpardonable sin is a sin that you didn't ask forgiveness for, or you know, something along those lines. So we can't say that it's that again for the same reasons, because Jesus said in this world or the next. So it's not the rejection of salvation. It's not unbelief until death. Otherwise, it ignores the original context in its entirety, because Jesus said what he said in response to the words spoken by the Pharisees. Now, how could the Pharisees have committed or at least come dangerously close to committing that sin if it's unbelief until death or it's the rejection of salvation as a whole? Those explanations completely disregard the context, completely disregard Christ's warning, and completely disregard the words in this world. So it can't be any of those. Now, it can't either be, it cannot be just general blasphemy. It cannot be just the cursing of God's name or Christ's name. Those are ugly sins, yes, but those alone, Christ himself said in this same context, he said, blasphemy against the Son of God or the Son of Man will be forgiven. He says, but blasphemy against the Holy Spirit will not be forgiven. So we know that it's not just general blasphemy. This is a very deliberate sin to commit, and it's very intentional. It's very specific. It's very dangerously close and pride-filled person that commits such a sin. So let's bring a balance to this. What is the blasphemy of the Holy Spirit? I'll tell you right now. We know for a fact that because of what Jesus said, the blasphemy of the Holy Spirit is the attribution of the Holy Spirit's work to demonic work. It's saying the Holy Spirit is a demon. Now, as I said before, we don't know if the Pharisees committed it or were dangerously close to committing it. But here's how you can know that you have not committed it. And again, this is very intentional, something you have to do with a heart filled with stubbornness and pride, as the Pharisees who, in the middle of seeing miracles, in other words, I don't think the Pharisees really thought that Jesus wasn't God. I think after everything that they saw, that the Pharisees actually knew that he was the Son of God, they were just too prideful to accept it. So in their stubbornness, they called what they knew to be divine demonic. Now let's bring balance. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 3, remember scripture with scripture. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 3 says this, so I want you to know that no one speaking by the Spirit of God will curse Jesus, and no one will say Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. So nobody who has the Holy Spirit is going to curse Jesus, and therefore nobody who has the Holy Spirit is going to curse the Holy Spirit. Therefore, it is impossible for the Christian to commit the blasphemy of the Holy Spirit. Because you have the Holy Spirit in you, you're not going to truly curse them. Now, you may say things that sound similar to what the Pharisees said. Maybe you went to a service and you were ignorant. You thought originally that maybe a preacher was a fake, or the miracles that were happening were fake, or the slain in the spirit was fake or demonic. And you thought, and you truly in your heart thought that, and you asked God about it, and you were sincere in saying, I don't know, this doesn't look right. That is not the blasphemy of the Holy Spirit. That's skepticism of the work of man or the ministry of man. It's when you know that Christ is in it and you attribute it nonetheless to something that's demonic, that then you become dangerously close to committing this. So we do know that from the scripture, 1 Corinthians 12, 3, that if you're a believer, you're not going to commit this. It's not possible for you to commit this. So the unpardonable sin is a very intentional one. You cannot commit it by accident. And if you think you've committed it by accident, you're wrong. It's something that's, again, very intentional. So not only can the unpardonable sin not be forgiven, but the one who commits it is sure to not be interested in being forgiven. Now, how do I know this? Now, follow me, because this is the liberating thought. This is a very liberating thought I'm about to give you, but it's a little technical, at least in my mind it is. It may not come out that way, but we'll pray the Lord help me deliver it. John chapter 6, verse 36 through 37 says this, but you haven't believed in me, though you have seen me. Does that sound familiar? This looks like the situation where he's talking to the Pharisees. Of course, it's a different context. But Jesus said, you haven't believed in me, though you have seen me. So he's talking to the unbeliever who's seen him come and is still rejecting his identity. He says, however, those the Father has given to me will come to me, and I will never reject them. Now think about this. This gets a little complicated. This is a scripture that says that though there are unbelievers who've seen Jesus do his work and still reject him, that the ones who God has chosen will come to Christ, and Christ will never reject them. There we see that word never again. Never and reject. Now, never really means never, and reject really means reject. Therefore, when he says never reject, he really means he will never reject. So how do we reconcile this verse? What if someone has been called by God, he says, I'll never reject them, but at the same time committed the blasphemy of the Holy Spirit, where it says they'll never be forgiven. So this again seems like a contradiction. Never reject, never be forgiven. The truth is, that person can never be the same person. the one who can never be forgiven can never be the one that's never rejected. It's simple. How can God both reject and accept you? So, the person whom God has called will never commit the blasphemy of the Holy Spirit because God is still working on their heart. You know, when you came to Christ, you didn't call yourself to Christ. God called you. In fact, God calls to all. But there are some to whom God has, the scripture talks about a reprobate or the conscience is seared, has cut them off. And that's a true biblical concept. And it's scary, but it's true. Now, if I truly am following Christ, I'm not going to commit the blasphemy of the Holy Spirit. And if I commit the blasphemy of the Holy Spirit, I don't want to follow Christ. So if you in your heart are worried that you have committed the blasphemy of the Holy Spirit, it just means you haven't committed it. And if you're concerned about being forgiven by God, then it means you haven't committed it. And if you come to Christ, you can only do so because God is still working on your heart, and God is still working on your heart because you haven't committed it. So if the blasphemy of the Holy Spirit, that concept scares you, worries you, makes you fearful, makes you not want to commit it, or makes you want to ask God for forgiveness just in case, then you can rest assured by what we know to be the truth that you have not committed the blasphemy of the Holy Spirit. Now, what about others? Well, we can't determine if they've committed it or not. Only God knows who truly has committed the blasphemy of the Holy Spirit. But here's the simple truth that still remains. This doesn't change anything. That anyone who comes to Christ will never be rejected. That just means that anyone who comes to Christ hasn't committed it yet. So you continue to pray for your loved ones, because I really doubt they committed that sin. Even some Bible scholars have remarked that perhaps the physical appearance of Jesus must be in place for someone to commit the blasphemy of the Holy Spirit. I don't see anything in the scripture that says that's true or says it's not true, so I don't have any strong ideas on that either way. But what I do know is that Jesus promised to never reject anyone who comes to him. That can only mean that anyone who comes to him has never committed the blasphemy of the Holy Spirit. So I pray this has given you something to think about. It's brought peace to your heart and clarity to your mind. The takeaway here is that anyone who comes to Jesus will always be accepted, number one, and that if you're concerned about having committed this sin at all, you haven't committed it because the heart that's committed it doesn't care if they're forgiven or not. So rest assured, have peace, keep praying for your loved ones, and remember that it's very difficult. You have to be, it's very a very intentional thing to commit this. You have to, one, believe that it's God at work somewhere in your heart, or have an idea that it just might be God, and be stubborn enough to still attribute it to the devil anyway. So that is it for this edition of Spirit Church. I really pray that it blessed you. I want to pray with you now, and let's believe for God to bring peace to your mind in this specific area. And if you want to continue to study it, I'll leave my notes. I wrote an article on this, and I'll also leave you my notes here in the video description. So let's pray and believe for God to give you peace of heart right now. Come on, join your hands with mine over the screen here, and let's believe. So Father, in Jesus' name, Lord, I thank you for that one watching who right now is coming to you for peace. And Lord, they've come with questions in their heart and in their mind for themselves and for their loved ones. Remind them, Father, that you will never reject one who comes to you. And Father, that you are not the author of confusion, you are not the giver of fear, but you're the giver of peace, for you are the Prince of Peace. And precious Lord, I pray you would bring healing to the emotions, to the mind, to the heart, and to the body. Let your presence envelop them in a special way right now. Father, let them sense you near to them. I rebuke all fear, anxiety, and paranoia right now. I take authority over that in Jesus' name. And I pray that the truth of your word would break through right now. I thank you, Father. We love you. And we bless your name. In Jesus' name we pray. I want you to say it. Say amen. Thank you so much for watching. Now, I want to welcome now the new members to the Spirit Church family. We had quite a few of you join us over the break. The Spirit Church family now consists of over 100 members from all around the world. Here's the names of those who've just recently joined. I want you to know we love you. We're praying for you. I get to see all your names. My office sends them to me, and I pray over every single one who joins. Be sure to keep checking that email. We're going to send you these lessons in email. Subscribe to us here on YouTube. This is the time of the portion of the video now where if you're a member of Spirit Church, sow your tithes and offerings. Do it today. Don't delay it. Helps the ministry continue to go. And if you're someone who's watching, you're not a member of Spirit Church, but maybe you enjoy Encounter TV. Maybe you've been to some of our Encounter services. Maybe you watch our television program. Maybe you've been blessed by a book, a blog, whatever. This ministry is helping you. Just recognize that that is just the edification side of the ministry. There's a whole other arm of this ministry that works on evangelism of the lost. So we want to edify the believer, evangelize the lost. We do all three through international television, worldwide television, international events, and global discipleship. Your support helps us do that. Some of you can send in $30 right now. Some of you can do 10, some of you can do 5. Some of you can do 100, 500, 1,000. Here's my challenge to you. Become a monthly ministry supporter for $10, $20, or $30 a month, or give a one-time gift of $120 or $360 as your $10 gift for the whole year, or your $30 gift for the whole year. And we pray God will bless you for it. When you do, make sure to send us your prayer request so that we can pray with you. Anything you can do, one-time gift or monthly, it all helps, small or large. You're watching this right now. You're saying he's talking to someone else. He's talking to that other viewer. No, I'm talking to you. God wants to use you. And I need your partnership to help me keep spreading the gospel all around the world. We do this for souls. We do this for Jesus. Join the movement. Thousands are joining from all over the world. We're going to take this world for Christ, and we're going to see revival again in the land. I believe it with all my heart. Well, again, that is it for this edition of Spirit Church. I'm glad to be back here with you. We're starting a new year. We're excited about everything God is doing. So I want you to remember until next time, nothing is impossible with God. No matter what comes your way, no matter how tragic it may seem, no matter how, either we have standards or we don't. And everybody who says, well, you should be free, and they have kind of this.